What is your understanding of the neuroscience, or what can you tell us about the neuroscience behind conflict?
Yes, the perspective on neuroscience is that the neuroscience or biological perspective is about the way that a person is, just is. And so instead of believing that external factors help us shape an individual, this perspective instead believes that the internal aspects of an individual are more important than their actions. And so the brain's function is basically for us to preserve, to emote or act out how our behavior responds, and also our thinking. Those are the four things that are the basics for our brain function. And so there are three areas of our brain. There are three areas. And the first area is the reptilian brain. That's the regulation of our unconscious body functions, such as our breathing, our heart rate, our digestion, and our circulation. And it also is our behaviors that are related to this part of our brain are for self-preservation, our eating, defending our bodies, and also defending for our food source. And everybody knows that when we went into the pandemic last year, everybody was rushing to the grocery store and just cleaning off the shelves. That was that reptilian brain telling us we need to preserve as much as we possibly can to move on. The next portion of the brain is the mammalian brain. And it's involved with our consciousness, our thoughts, our memory, and our emotions, how we respond. And it also triggers our fight, flight, and freeze responses. And it's also involved with our social connections, how we connect with people. And then that third portion is the neocortex. And what's involved in the neocortex is our sensory perception, our motor commands, our spatial reasoning, and also our language. It also involves our conscious thought, including conscious interpretation of our emotional state.
Thank you so much for that, Chris. I mean, that's interesting to see how all these different things come together when we're having in the midst of conflict. But can we talk a little bit about our emotions during conflict?
Yes, what happens is, as a conflict resolver, when we folks who touch people, like our doctors and our psychotherapists, we work with individuals who are experiencing conflict. And whether it's with the self, others, or tangibles, we're quick to find clarity to get them to the root of the problem. And so the psychology of people is such that emotions will be impacted almost instantaneously. Emotions sit at the surface and appear first, specifically when a fight or flight conflict arises. The reaction in our brain resides in the amygdala, located near the hippocampus of the frontal temporal lobe in the brain. And so at the initial moment of conflict, our brain cortisol levels release instantaneously, causing us to overreact in 0 to 60 seconds. And so anger builds up quickly while blood rushes to our brains. And how many of you can feel blood rising in your body and feel that hot anger? When we're in conflict, it's mostly all in our physical bodies. We feel the sweaty hands, the palpitation of our hearts, all of those things are happening at that time. And so these are the physiological reactions when an individual is experiencing conflict. The reaction happens so quickly that the brain becomes stressed. And when the brain is under stress, stress can last longer in us than expected, and it impacts the hippocampus, reducing our cognition, resulting in brain fog. And in brain fog, it refers to the inability to think rationally and usually occurs when we're in conflict. Over time, anger, stress, and other negative emotions, if not dealt with, will impact the ability to learn and remember new information. Memory loss becomes a norm.
So in times of conflict, why can't we always see eye to eye?
Because we're all in our emotion. We're not thinking about how to resolve a conflict. And so as a conflict resolver, that is part of my job, is to get people out of that emotional state and into cognition. And the way I do that is I ask a question. What's going on with you right now? How does that make you feel? Because I want them to feel the emotions. I want them to get the emotions out, but then they have to actually think about what's going on with them. And then I ask them, so what do you think about that? Once they've described those feelings, just like in the beginning, I asked, what is conflict? And everybody said their responses, what their responses to conflict was. I try to get them to now that you know how you're feeling, why are you feeling that way? And so once they get into cognition, they start thinking about ways of managing or changing or addressing the conflict.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Can you talk about the prefrontal cortex in conflict?
Yes, the prefrontal cortex, for all its sophistication, is not always right. It will consider input from many other areas of the brain and pull it into that coherent understanding. And that's what happens with the question. However, if there's not sufficient information, it will use what it has and drag in other material. And you will not always know what it drags in. And what it drags in is all of those life experience, all of those treasures is what I call them, because we get a lot of treasures and we have these little treasure boxes that we just store it all up in. Things from our parents, our families, our preachers, our teachers, you know, all of these things that we have in this box that we pull from when we're in conflict. But there comes a time when we need to go and look in that box and we need to clean it out. We need to take out a little selfishness, a little self-doubt, a little discomfort. We need to take some of those things out of the box and leave the things that we need that will actually move us toward resolving conflict.
So that can explain sometimes why we have these different perspectives in the midst of conflict, because our brains are trying to reason from our perspectives and other people are reasoning from their perspectives. So, you know, we can have a clash there.
Absolutely. And what happens when people are in conflict? You have two people butting heads or their fists together. And so long as that tension is there, you've got conflict. But what happens if one person moves away? Where's that other one going to go? And so that's how you try to handle conflict, is you either stop and think about, what is my role in this conflict? If your answer is none, then you have the ability to let that other person know that you choose not to engage in their conflict because it's not yours. That I have found.